Bottom Line, an SKN Vibes production that highlights political, social, and cultural issues and events within the Twin Island Federation of St. Kitts and Nevis, the Caribbean region, and for the refuge. A very good day to all who have logged on to SKNvibes.com. I am Stanford Conway, host for today's episode of Bottom Line, which is part of a series of panel discussions on and analyses of political, social, and cultural issues and events between St. Kitts and Nevis, the Caribbean region, and further afield. Today's discussion will be on hindrances to increased agriculture products. In the studio to discuss this very important topic with me is the Permanent Secretary within the Ministry of Agriculture, Mr. Alistair Edwards, better known as Al. Welcome to Bottom Line, Mr. Edwards.
Thank you very much, Mr. Conway.
Yeah, before we go on, I would like you to briefly inform the listeners what are your responsibilities as the Permanent Secretary within the Ministry of Agriculture.
Well, at the moment, I am the Permanent Secretary in the Ministry of Agriculture, Marine Resources, Cooperatives, Environment, and Human Settlement. This is but a fraction of the departments or ministries that fall under the Honorable Eugene Hamilton. And in terms of direct responsibilities, mainly they are overarching or supervisory roles, so to speak, in relation to what happens in terms of agriculture, what happens in terms of all those other departments. And of course, the government would say you are the final accounting officer in terms of spending money in relation to agricultural development, marine resources, or the other areas that I called.
Okay. Could you also tell the viewers some of the hindrances to increased agricultural production?
I'm glad you asked that question, and I'm glad that I have the opportunity to hear some of the hindrances that we've experienced over the years. And in my books and from my experience being in and around agriculture for more than 30 years, I would say the number one factor is the presence of the green velvet monkey on our shores.
Why the monkeys?
The monkey is a very intelligent animal. It doesn't have a natural prey. As a result, it can multiply unchecked. And so the population as it stands today, we suspect, would be probably 1-to-1 in terms of humans to monkeys. They can be very vicious in terms of damage they can do to crops. They can take out an entire crop in a very short space of time by sheer numbers. And of course, sometimes they're not satisfied, so they will come a second time and hurt you. In my experience, I've seen grown men cry like babies after monkeys have been finished with them. And not just the damage factor, there are persons who have gone out of production because of the presence of monkeys. They will simply not farm. I usually say if I could wake up one morning and say to many people in St. Kitts and Nevis, there are no green velvet monkeys, I would have a rush of people going back into agriculture. It would be uncontrollable. And the theory is, once we control the presence of the monkeys down to economic threshold level, production would increase by at least 55%. Wow. Without any other effort. Just that control alone of the green velvet monkeys, production is expected to increase by about 55%. Now, of course, there are other hindrances. such as water, such as timely land prep, which such as access to markets overseas, which we can discuss throughout this program. But if you ask me, the number one factor, the number one hindrance, I put it squarely in the lap of the Peruvian velvet monkeys.
Now, I have spoken to a number of farmers, and some of them have told me that they have been using dogs to wild all of these monkeys. But then I get to understand, as you spoke of them being intelligent, they befriended dogs after a while?
Of course.
Have you came across any of the farmers who would have related such to you?
Oh, of course. We have stories of monkeys riding on dogs' back. We have stories of monkeys actually killing dogs. You know, a gang of them would gang up on a monkey and use their sharp nails to cut him, and he bleeds to death.
Wow.
Yeah. But of course, there are some other vicious dogs that certainly take care of monkeys. The pit bulls, breed, and if you train them to have the taste of going after monkeys and so on, they can be very effective. But as I say, it's not any dog. And a lot of the times, the farmers would have to tie the dogs in order to keep them controlled.
Okay.
And the monkeys, as I said, they're so intelligent and so inquisitive. They would sit and observe and notice the range of the dog and simply get around him. Yeah. But we're not giving up.
I had visited the Taiwanese farm once, and I saw they have installed a kind of electric fence. So what about that, where the agriculture the ministry is concerned?
Right. When I say we're not giving up, we are embarking upon a number of angles. One of them, well, first of all, we've just gotten some funding, government funding, to do a more recent population census. We want it a bit more official, we want it a bit more scientific. And so we've employed the services of a primatologist to study and observe the monkeys. And of course, she's going to use a collar that can be tracked via satellite, trap the monkeys, put the collar in it, and allow it to go back into the wild. Once he mingles with his troop, you'll be able to tell from the density around him the numbers that are there. So once you determine the numbers of each troop, and then you can determine the number of troops, you can get a more scientific estimation of the monkeys. That's step one. That is about halfway completed now. We should be finished in the next 3 to 6 months. Once we determine the number of monkeys on St.kitts and Nevis, then we can have strategies of controlling them and managing them. One such, as you mentioned, is a combination of barrier methods. That is anything that prevents the monkey from going past a certain area. The electrical fence is one such. But very recently, I was told that, you know, the monkeys go and test the fence to see if it's working.
Really? Mean like a sacrificial lamb?
Something like that. They would send one or two monkeys to actually touch the wire. And in some days, when sometimes you have like a battery outage, or it's heavily overcast when because it's dependent on solar. Solar energy charges the battery. So if you have overcast and a very rainy day, they would go and test to see if everything is working. And if not, they go over. Added to that, I'm also told that if it is not a certain height, they simply build up momentum and jump over. Just like a high jumper. If you'll be amazed to see that. They go in that way and come out the next way. They pick up momentum over the fence. So if you have a 5-foot fence with a string, the wire on top, that might not be able to stop them because
they jump higher than that.
And I would probably go as far as to say the pole vault, they find a pole and pole vault over. They're that intelligent, I wouldn't put it past them. But let me continue on the aspect of barriers.
Yeah.
Because we have not other barrier methods. We have a gentleman, a young man, who's just come back from Cuba, did his doctorate. He's experimenting with barrier using cassia, or acacia is the scientific name for it. He wants to have the farms bordered with acacia because, you know, it's a spiny plant and monkeys are very much like humans, they don't want anything to dig them. So he's done some experiments with at least two farmers, and we haven't had the reports as yet. The other one is a bit more expensive, but apparently it's working well. And that's an idea from yours truly, and I call it the monkey-proof house. It's just like a shade house, but rather than using plastic, we use a mesh wire, like a fish pot wire that is fine. Uh-huh. Roof, sides, front, everything, almost like a house, but it's just mesh wire. So the monkeys will not be able to get in. So you can plant, actually plant inside this house. We've only done one so far. We put it in the Phillips area, and we're testing to see the efficacy of it in terms of the monkeys, because all they can do is probably reach in a hand and pull something out if you plant too close to the edge
fence.
Of the, to the edge of the house. Uh-huh. And we want to put those in what we call monkey territory and see how effective they are. But of course, there's going to be an initial cost. But if you can plant successfully in monkey territory up at the higher levels when it's much cooler, and you're planting like the cold crops and cabbages and so on, I'm sure, I'm almost 100% certain that you'll make back your money before the second cycle of crops.
You had earlier said that there would be increased numbers of farmers.
Of course.
Who would return to the soil once there's a control system.
Yeah.
Especially if they hear the no vervet monkeys. But then again, let's look at it from another perspective. The monkeys are being used in tourism.
Yeah. Right.
So what happens then?
I'm glad you mentioned that, because my mantra is that monkey business should be everybody's business. I want, my drive today is to, and that's why I got the opportunity to come and Open Interactive. My drive today is to get the nation thinking that everybody has a part to play in controlling these monkeys. On the tourism side, they seem to be a hit. The guys make money from taking pictures. The tourists are very fascinated. If you go over to Friars Bay North, Friars Bay, I think it's Shipwreck area.
Yeah.
Where they literally feed the monkeys by hand. And so it's a big thrill for the tourists. So on the one hand, the tourism is making money from it. On the other hand, it's a scourge to the farmers. I'm wondering if the farmers ever go over there and see the tourists doing that, how they would react.
Okay.
Apart from that too, we've just had a press conference where there's a professor at Ross University who has this theory that monkeys may be somehow involved in the transmission or at least the resting period of the chikungunya and the Zika viruses. And see, so they just attracted about $300,000 to do a project here on St.kitts to trap monkeys and test to see if the monkeys are actually host to these viruses. Because his theory is, okay, we had an upsurge of Zika and chikungunya. Where did it go? Is it just resting in a while in the bloodstream of these monkeys and then they'd flare up again? I mean, really, I would love if that hypothesis proved positive, in the sense that it would put a lot more tension on us, it would do a lot more trapping, they would want to do a lot more studies, and so we can trap monkeys humanely to study that possibility, because it's really new. And the people who they got the money from, these are not just people who give in money, just anything like that. So it means that they were really impressed with the project proposal to do the study between man and monkey and the possibility there was an OCS.
Okay, so let's look at it from
just this. Just let me finish this point though.
Okay.
We had tourism, mm-hmm. We have health, we have agriculture. Those are three broad areas I spoke with us about just now. Monkeys and health, monkeys in tourism, monkeys in agriculture. This is why I'm saying it has to be everybody's business. And even going further now, monkeys are coming down in your homes now. People cannot grow their own backyard gardens. So even that's not a government sector, it's certainly a social factor to deal with. So you have four broad areas that monkeys involved in. So going back to my point, monkey business is everybody's business.
So what advice would you have for the people saying that this monkey business is everybody's mm-hmm. business? What would you say advise people to do?
Okay, my main thing would be to use the barrier methods. Hence, they would certainly want to have some sort of investment. If you're going to invest in an effective barrier method. In my mind, the monkey profiles can work, especially if you're high. Secondly, the electric fence can work, but it's going to need proper maintenance. And of course, you can also use decoy crops. Because previously, in days gone by, that's one of the factors that the older farmers would mention. The hills used to have things like mansy port, fat pork, strawberries, sour oranges, sweet or sour oranges, some wild avocados and things like that. The hurricanes took them out. And everybody says, sit back and say, well, the hurricanes knocked them down. Who's going to plant them back? Is it me? Is it you? Is it government? Is it the farmers? And so that's one of the things I would encourage them to, even while they're concentrating on their crop of choice, they say about putting something like this. It's not too costly that the monkeys can go with. For instance, I'm sure they can get some sets of cane. To plant a little patch of cane. Monkeys like cane. Low maintenance, very low cost in terms of starting it up. So you border your place with cane. Some other cheap crop. Once upon a time, they used to use something they call kohlrabi, which was about $5 for a pound. It looks like carrots. I think it tastes like carrots too. And so the monkeys were glad to know that they're pulling up things like that. You can lose $5 if you want to. Make sure you.
In 2005, mm-hmm. the sugar industry closed. Became defunct.
Correct.
Compare the days or the years before then, 2005, to what it is today, currently. Mm-hmm. Are you saying that the monkeys has become more destructive now, where the farmers are losing more than how they would have lost prior to 2005?
Most definitely.
So we're talking the cane?
Correct. When you had the cane, and in the heyday of sugar cane, the sugar cane industry employed persons to shoot monkeys, at least to keep them off. Added to that, you had a lot more sugar cane than crops. So if you were in St. Kitts at the time, you'd realize almost every arable acre on St. Kitts was sugar cane. And so not only that too, at that point in time, they had other crops in the hills to eat as well.
Okay.
So you've removed those two main sources. There's not much cane now. There's not much natural fruits in the area now. So they naturally thrive or go to where the food is.
Yeah, I've seen somewhere I reside in Newtown.
But I told you that.
Yeah, I see a number of them.
Yep.
With the experiment on these monkeys being conducted at Ross University,
mm-hmm.
it means that they will go about trapping them.
Correct.
What about population control, seeing that they would be trapping a number mm-hmm. of them? What happens then?
That has always been discussed in that they want to ensure that the females in particular don't have the ability to reproduce. Similarly, in the males. The discussion has not yet been exhausted as to how they're going about it, but they're thinking about certainly sterile methods in monkeys, both male and female. I've heard the discussion, but I haven't heard anything conclusive about it yet as to what exactly would they have to do to them once they trap them to ensure that they don't breed again. Yeah.
Moving off of the monkey business, so to speak.
Monkey business, yes.
And looking more to agriculture production.
Mm-hmm.
I had heard that some system that you have used in the past,
mm-hmm.
farmers have used in the past, they have resorted to that mm-hmm. in the production of cabbage.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it was over 10,000,
mm-hmm.
I say pounds or 10,000 or mm-hmm. whatever you call it, with the cabbage. What farmers have been crying out that.
Mm-hmm.
To boost or increase production, they need more land, is one,
mm-hmm.
apart from the hindrances, water. But what of the product itself? I can remember years gone by, you had an entity called Semaco.
Mm-hmm.
Could you tell me what Semaco was doing then and why is it not in place today?
Mm-hmm. The Central Marketing Corporation was intended to handle the marketing for and on behalf of farmers. It worked in the early stages, mainly because the Simakoden was very aggressive. They did not wait until the commodity was out of the ground. They had trans vehicles to get to the farms. They would get in contact with the farmers. And even before the crop is matured, they would have more or less an understanding that once this crop is completed, I'm coming for it.
Okay.
And so they took the crop from the field, literally took it from the field, and took it to the supermarket where they treated it, washed it, and packaged it, and so on. That worked for a while, and you probably realize that they probably couldn't do that with all the farmers.
Mm-hmm.
Development, farmers began to get vehicles, farmers began to negotiate with other supermarkets. So if Simako doesn't come for my goods today, I'm taking it to Rams, and to other supermarkets and other areas to get them sold. And so, over time, Simako was relegated to another ordinary supermarket.
Okay.
And it was simply competition. In order to survive, when they felt the brunt of the competition, they did a lot of other things apart from being a central marketing corporation. They operated like a normal supermarket, from plastic bags to alcohol on the shelves.
Yeah,
and in some countries, even television sets, the central marketing used to history.
Was that entity financed by the government?
There was a subvention that was given to by government at one point in time until they operated more or less on their own. It started out by them getting a subvention. I think in the latter years, they weren't getting any subventions from the government. But the concept of a central marketing corporation, I think that's where you really want to go. And I want to underscore the point that what happened initially is what should have continued, or what need to continue if a central marketing is going to work. Meaning, and it might sound outrageous here, that all the marketed or all the produce intended for the market should go through one area. The farmers, quote unquote, I said this gently, should not be allowed to negotiate with other supermarkets. Are you a farmer? As your farmer, you have any produce? Everything should go through the central marketing corporation. Then the other supermarkets will come to the central marketing corporation to buy. If that doesn't pertain, it's not going to work. I've seen it, I've traveled, I've been around agriculture for quite a while, and I've seen it in other countries where the cooperatives are the ones that control the central marketing. And as you're part of a cooperative, you're not going to undersell or take your business out of your cooperative by going straight to a supermarket. So everything goes to the cooperative which operates the central marketing entity. And then everybody comes in and bid on the commodities or purchase the commodities. And that is the way it has to work. This is not going to work. If you're gonna sell a couple of £1,000, you can go £100 to supermarket A, £100 to supermarket B.
I get you. Well, I spoke to some farmers and ideas start floating.
Mm-hmm.
And I had even make mention of what I had seen transpired in my country of birth, that's Guyana.
Correct.
Mm-hmm. Where we had the Guyana Marketing Corporation.
Correct.
And the suggestion was that the farmers, as you say, the cooperative, they bring their produce to this corporation, so to speak, and they would be paid.
Mm-hmm.
But instead of them having to find a market, that is the responsibility of that entity.
Correct.
And the time that they would have taken to go into the market or at the sidewalks to have their produce sold or the supermarkets or whatever the case may be, they could be on the farm producing more, time consuming.
Yep.
Right? So the suggestion was from these farmers, why the government don't take that in hand so they can alleviate some of the burden of the farmers?
I could answer that simply by saying, I'll use an example using a numbers game. A certain entity like that, wouldn't be able to take a certain number. You agree? Certain, okay. Let's say pounds or kilograms of whatever commodity. And I'm going to use a real example of what happened and just put it in simple numbers. The government entity asks for, let's say, 1,000 pounds of a particular produce. Four farmers bring along 250 pounds. You don't want any more. That's the capacity that you can, and you're depending on supermarket A to buy from you, supermarket B to buy from you as a government entity. But those four farmers, they produce more than 250 pounds. They actually each produce 1,000 pounds.
Okay.
What are they going to do with their 750? They are going to the same supermarket that you want to sell to. Sell to them. Where would you sell to your stuff?
I understand.
You understand my point.
Correct.
And I've come down to something I mentioned at the top of the program. Getting transport to penetrate export markets. That's another hindrance. Because St.kitts is a small market. St.kitts is a very small market. We say we usually say a population of 50,000, and we're not even quite there yet. That's adding in some dogs and some pups and some dolls at 50,000. It's only so much that 50,000 people can eat. So it means you have to penetrate other markets. And the transport has been a scourge that's been plaguing us. It got up to even CARICOM level, where we cannot effectively move goods and between and among Caribbean islands cost effectively. Goods come from Miami easier and cheaper than goods going from St. Kitts Nevis to St. Lucia. Because of the transportation, and that's another big hindrance.
I think that a few weeks ago, at the CARICOM level, there was a discussion of transportation, and I think it was by boat, by water.
Correct.
Now, how I see it, what about the CARICOM heads coming together? They have that system going, with the boat system, and for example, you find that I look at the soil here in St. Kitts and Nevis, very rich.
Of course.
And when I compare that to the soil in Guyana, Guyana has a lot of clay.
Clay.
Mm-hmm. Now, Guyana does not produce potatoes. They do not produce onions. St. Kitts produce that. Guyana produces sugar. Guyana produces rice. What about the barter system? You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So these farmers who would have had 1,000 pounds each of whatever the commodity is, but they could have only given...
Comes back to my question. How are we going to get it to Guyana?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. there's a point with the CARICOM heads coming together and make a stand.
As far back as a gentleman by the name of Jack Dillon, I know you know very well, they've been trying. They started by doing studies in the windwards of how to move produce through and through. I think the windwards just start getting it right, at least as a little entity. So they can move goods between St. Lucia, Dominica, or Dominica and the French Islands, St. Lucia and the French Islands. They've been doing fairly well there, quietly. But there's nothing up this way, up this side. And there's nothing to link the windwards to the leewards, or the windwards and leewards to some of the bigger entities like the Barbados and Trinidad and so on. In fact, some of the windwards go down to Trinidad for sure. So they have that link already. But up north, St. Kitts Nevis, that's where we suffer a bit more. We have smaller markets, but certainly we can't get to move goods. I've been singing this song for years, and I'm glad I'm getting a chance to get it out, in that the aspect of a multi-purpose boat, one that can take both produce and people. You have a shortfall in produce, you don't have much demand, you take people. You have a shortfall in people, not but people traveling, you take produce, you take both together. And I've seen drawings and samples of boats that are like that. Fast ferries, they could get to St. Martin rather quickly. 2.5 hours, St.kitts to St. Martin, hop over to Anguilla. Small markets, but once we know how to do the small things well, then we can move.
Big ones.
Of course.
I see, I get a point.
But at the moment, the surface is unreliable and the air is way too expensive in terms of transport. And that, in my mind, is a big hindrance to agricultural production.
So, as a matter of fact, when we talk about CSME, mm-hmm. definitely there is a need mm-hmm. for the CARICOM heads of government to come together mm-hmm. and to come with a plan mm-hmm. that can facilitate, facilitate this kind of strategy, so to speak, in getting your produce out to, out to St. Kitts and around the various islands and other countries.
Can we know anything? I think that the CARICOM heads, from being close to them, they are kind of not too sure which way to go, whether it should be a government entity to start it or a private entity. And so they want to, whose responsibility is really to start? And I think that's where it lies right now. They would much prefer to say a private entity comes in and take up that slack rather than for government to invest in that area. That's the impression I'm getting.
Well, look at LIAT.
Correct.
It could be something like LIAT, but have more countries embodied there.
Yeah.
And it would do well for CARICOM because the majority of foodstuff mm-hmm. we are importing.
True.
Very important.
Well, as you mentioned LIAT, I think LIAT would be one of the factors that contributes to the success of my fast ferry system, my dual purpose, because the prices for travel nowadays is astronomical.
Right now it's $2,700 to travel from here to Guyana.
That's like $1,000 US. St. Martin is almost like $400 US. Okay. And if I can take somebody down there for $300 US, it's not going to take you 20 minutes on a plane, but 300 EC, 400 EC. See what I'm saying? And alongside that, I'd have my stack of cargo on the lower deck or the upper deck.
Okay, you know that you would have plans. And let's say this is plan A.
Mm-hmm.
There's supposed to be a plan B.
Mm-hmm.
Now, let's look at plan B, where those farmers,
mm-hmm.
where they would have been taken to the entity, the cooperative, certain mm-hmm. amount of their produce. And we talk about, put a figure, £1,000.
Yeah.
And a large number is remaining
mm-hmm.
on the farmer's hand. What can we do with those produce? What can we do with them? Can't we move towards preservation now?
Yeah, I'm sorry that we had to bring it in from the idea of excess
mm-hmm.
because agro-processed items, in my mind, is really the future of export from small countries. We have excellent products. A lot of them will be lightweight, easier to ship. They are preserved, harder to spoil than fresh produce. Take for instance something like guava cheese.
Mm-hmm.
It's a skill that doesn't reside in a lot of countries. St.kitts is very well known for guava cheese. St. Lucia. I can't call many other countries that do guava cheese. And we are sitting on almost like a pot of gold with guava cheese. Sarsaparilla, very distinctive taste from St. Kitts again. These are things that we can market and put on a boat, put on a plane. So that, in my mind, is plan B. It really shouldn't be plan B, it should be plan A, because I believe they'll do better than the fresh produce. But let's go with niche market for these items that St. Kitts is well known for. In fact, even in sarsaparilla, some people tell you that the Navy sarsaparilla tastes better than the St. Kitts sarsaparilla. and they have made a name for themselves out there. Okay. And now we've taken on a unit at the Department, Ministry of Agriculture, that produces about 15, 20 products that have already been tested in the market. The cassava flour, sweet potato flour, pumpkin flour, banana chips, plantain chips, juices, jams, jellies, condiments, all those, I mean, they can last months in a container and target niche markets and get them out there. These same ones can go on a plane and bear the cost rather than fresh produce, which is much more bulky,
yeah,
weighty.
Those are lightweight.
Correct. Correct.
So what is impeding such a move?
I would say it's a lot of it is a will among people. I mean, some of it is being done, you know, don't get me wrong, but on a very small scale, right? Some farmers are actually getting into the BVI market, some into the St. Martin market, but on a small scale. Nothing much to call home about, but they continue, and it continues to build up, and people begin to see that we can make money from this. But it's just a matter of having that will, that taking that economic chance, so to speak, and making that investment to do something like that. And I believe we're just on the edge of breaking through. I honestly believe that.
We know that. Excuse me. For all businesses, mm-hmm, to be successful.
Correct.
Advertisement.
Oh yeah.
So why doesn't the ministry start a program of advertisement, mm-hmm, so as to sensitize the people, mm-hmm, and at the same time motivate others who would get into, mm-hmm, that avenue of business?
Maybe we do far too little, or maybe we do our advertisement in areas that not really prime time or primary, because we have our own radio program,
yeah,
we have our own TV program. A lot of the products now that are in the market, the agro-processed items, they bear our labels. So the labels should speak for itself. Our next step in terms of promoting is a website. Well, it's a platform where you can log on and actually do marketing, see what's available, see who has it, and actually purchase from it. But that's going to be rolled out in the next couple of months, so to speak. I think we've already gotten the funding for that.
Mm-hmm.
And the IT department is helping us out there. So you will be able to log on to our website to see the farmers who have all the produce, what they have, price, contact numbers, and you yourself can get onto it. Yeah, and of course, you'll see pictures of it.
I think that would do well, but because with technology.
Yes. But well. I agree with you that we are guilty that we don't blow our own trumpet enough in terms of promoting the things, the good things that we've done. A lot of people still don't know that, you know, this thing happened. For instance, I mentioned about guava cheese now. A lot of people don't know that St.kitts is really, really has the knowledge and skill for guava cheese really lives here.
Well, I'm one of those who are ignorant of it. You know, bring it to me.
Wonderful. So yeah. I have one more customer.
Yeah.
One more customer.
I like it.
You like guava cheese?
I like guava cheese.
Wonderful.
Yeah, you know, as a small boy,
yeah,
my mother used to make it.
Oh, wonderful. Yeah.
Right.
And I'm sure, unfortunately, she probably didn't pass on the skill to your sister.
My sister.
She's doing it? Okay, yeah. Wonderful. Yeah. In a good line. Yeah. Stay there.
So, what is the bottom line message you would like to get out to the people there?
Well, let me go back to my number one concern. Monkey business is everybody's business. I want the nation of St.kitts and Nevis get into the business of controlling monkeys. As our number one concern, and I'm putting my neck on a block. I'm going to put my name on the airwaves that once we control monkeys below an economic threshold level, production in St.kitts will increase by at least 50-55%. That is my bottom line today.
Okay. Now, Mr. Edwards, I must thank you for coming here and sharing what the Ministry of Agriculture,
mm-hmm,
is engaged in, what plans they are,
correct,
and at the same time letting the people know,
mm-hmm,
that the monkey business is our business, everybody's business. Everybody. But I'm going to give you a forwarding. I don't want to say warning, but invitation. Sometime in the future, I may mm-hmm. call upon you again for us to discuss the progress along the line.
Oh, most definitely.
Of what the agriculture
ministry
is doing.
I'll be glad. I'll be definitely glad, because by that time our census should be finished and I'll be able to say officially the population of monkeys in St. Kitts, and we go on from there and there.
Yeah, let's keep our fingers crossed and hope that is it, so that we can see production rising to that level and that you'll achieve, the farmers will achieve a better means of livelihood. So once again, thank you for coming.
You're welcome.
Thank you for watching. Until the next time. For feedback, you can contact us at newsroom@sknvibes.com, or you may call us at telephone numbers 869-466-9242 or in the cell 662-3903. Goodbye.